I was recently walking in Las Vegas when I ran into the world's largest chocolate fountain at the Jean-Philippe Patisserie, a 20 feet tall fountain of melted chocolate. Once the hypnotic effect of the chocolate flow ended, different questions struck my mind. How can this be the sign? How can they make sure that the fountain runs continuously for over a year? Well, some engineering considerations can be made on the piping system that the fountain relies on. Fluid flowing through a pipe or a channel is subject to hydraulic losses caused by viscous effects, generally driven by cross-section shape and surface roughness. The energy losses can be described in terms of a hydraulic head that can be directly connected to the Bernoulli's principle. Now, recall that the Bernoulli's equation is a representation of the conservation of energy in a fluid. With this equation, we can describe the total energy head for an incompressible flow in a gravitational field as a sum of a pressure term, the kinetic energy, and the local height of the fluid. The hydraulic head represents the flow energy and has units of length, since can be seen as an equivalent height of a static column of fluid. For inviscid flows, the term h is constant, while for viscous flows is not. Let's consider a generic case. We have an inclined pipe of length L and diameter D, with a fluid passing through it at a certain velocity and subject to a gravitational field. If we consider two different locations along the pipe, location 1 and location 2, we can describe the hydraulic head at the two locations. For both locations, we have the three main terms, the pressure term, the kinetic term, and the potential term. But we can notice that in the location 2, we have also an additional term, HL, that represents the head loss due to the viscous effects. Indeed, as the flow moves through the pipe, there will be a certain head loss generated by the interaction of the fluid with the pipe walls. Now, for any compressible, fully developed flow in a level pipe, the Z terms are the same, as well as the velocity through the pipe. This let us obtain an expression for the head loss in terms of a scaled pressure difference between the two locations. Head losses can be divided in two main categories. The major losses, they are connected to the friction in straight pipes, and the minor losses, due to different components in the piping system, such as bolts, bends, junctions, and so on. In this lesson, we will analyze the major losses in pipes and ducts. Let's start our analysis considering a fully developed incompressible turbulent flow in a circular pipe. If we analyze the cross-section of the pipe, we can define the control volume between locations 1 and 2 that are at a distance L from each other. The flow at the two locations presents a fully developed velocity profile and its characteristic velocity and pressure. On the side of the control volume defined by the pipe wall, we have friction and the wall shear stress acts on the fluid. The area of the three faces of the control volume is described by simple geometrical relations. Note that here the pipe is horizontal, and so the gravity effects can be neglected. We can now apply the integral form of the momentum equation to our control volume. The momentum flux is non-zero only on location 1 and location 2. For the forces acting on the control volume, we have the shear force due to the shear stress at the walls, and the pressure forces acting on the locations 1 and 2. For an incompressible flow, the two terms on the left-hand side are the same and cancel out due to the opposite orientation of the normal vector. The equation then can be simplified into a simple expression that relates the pressure drop due to viscous effects to the wall shear stress and the pipe dimensions. The values of pressure and shear stress presented here are surface area average quantities. This because average values are sufficient in pipe flow analysis for engineering applications. The expression for the pressure drop along the pipe can be substituted into the head loss relation we just derived. This gives us a direct expression for the head loss, where we can see that for level straight pipes, the head loss is only connected to the shear stress. This equation is valid both for laminar and turbulent flows. Let's now recall the definition for the skin friction coefficient and the Darcy friction factor. That is just the skin friction coefficient multiplied by a factor of 4. Combining these two relations with the shear stress, we can obtain an expression of the pressure drop along the pipe in terms of the Darcy friction factor. The relation was developed in the mid-19th century by Henri Darcy, a French engineer, without using any integral analysis, but only through dimensional analysis. With this equation, we can define a pipe flow based on the pipe dimension, the flow rate, and the density of the fluid. And after determining an appropriate friction factor, we can estimate the pressure drop along the pipe. For smooth pipes, the Darcy friction factor is a function of the Reynolds number. In real world, however, pipes are not smooth. Each pipe has its own surface texture. For example, a new pipe can be fairly smooth, while an older pipe can be corroded and rusty, so its internal surface is rougher. The surface texture of a pipe can be described as a sand roughness height, or through an equivalent grain roughness height. Different surface textures can be represented by the same parameter. In this way, we can recast the Darcy friction factor as a function of the Reynolds number and surface roughness. Hence, the head loss can be expressed in this slightly modified formulation. This relation is known as the Darcy-Weisbach equation, and it's valid for any fully developed, steady, incompressible pipe flow. How can we estimate the friction factor and the pressure drop for any generic pipe? In 1944, Lewis Ferry Moody, professor at the Princeton University, published what is now called the Moody diagram. This diagram is a collection of information that connects the friction factor with the Reynolds number and the relative pipe roughness for different materials. The single chart provides all the available friction factor data, and it's a common tool to estimate pressure loss in pipes. Most of the correlation data presented here in this chart were derived first from experimental analysis by Nicuradze in 1933, who artificially roughened the pipes by adhering sand grains of known size and then measuring the pressure drop at different flow rates. As you can see, the laminar flow is independent on the wall roughness. This because the laminar layer extends up to the center line of the pipe, while in turbulent flows, the laminar layer is really thin and is directly affected by the surface roughness of the pipe. Looking at the chart, we can also see that at high Reynolds numbers, the friction factor becomes independent on the Reynolds number. This region is identified by the complete turbulence dashed line. This because in thin laminar layers, the surface roughness dominates the near wall characteristics. The Moody chart can be summarized by a single formula valid for the entire non-laminar range. The Colebrook formula. This relation is implicit in F and must be solved numerically. Another researcher, Halland, derived an explicit approximation of this equation that can be directly applied to estimate the friction factor. The Moody diagram and the Colebrook formula are based on experimental data and cannot provide exact predictions. Usually, the predictions present a range of error of about 10% that in certain design analysis can be acceptable. The application of the Moody diagram can be also extended to non-circular pipes, replacing the diameter with the hydraulic diameter. However, this reduces further the accuracy of the predictions due to differences in the flow patterns between circular and non-circular pipes.